Thank you for joining The Change I Am Possible, which is India's first future tech podcast. And today I'm delighted to have with me two guests from the Good Food Institute, Nicole Rock, who is the innovation specialist at GFI. So prior to joining GFI India, Nicole worked at Invest India, the National Investment Promotion and Facilitation Agency of the Government of India, as a special project nomination via Invest India. She worked under the office of the Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India to launch the National Innovation Commercialization Initiative, AGNI. And Nicole is passionate about climate action and public health. Dr. Akshay Bhatt is the Science and Technology Specialist at GFI. Akshay holds a BSc in biotechnology, a master's in medical biochemistry, and a PhD in cancer and muscle biology from the National University of Singapore. He was most recently a founder of Falcon Bio, a cancer drug delivery and services platform based out of Singapore. Akshay is an accomplished scientist and entrepreneur. So welcome to the show, and it's a pleasure to have you guys talk about what's coming. So I'm super excited about the future of food and what's going to offer. So Nicole, why don't you start with explaining what Good Food Institute is and what's its vision?
Thank you, Eddie. It's great to be here. And put simply, we're an organization of scientists, entrepreneurs, investors, trying to diversify protein sources for a healthier, more sustainable and just food system. We primarily work across three broad pillars, the first being science and technology. Our team of PhD scientists works to advance the foundational science of alternative protein. Our corporate engagement team builds relationships with some of the world's largest food manufacturers, meat companies, restaurants, and retailers to help them capitalize on opportunities in alternative protein. Within our corporate engagement team sits the innovation team that I am a part of. Primarily, I work to build out the early stage ecosystem for alternative protein, as well as work with investors and financial institutions to build out their thesis for investing in this sector. And then finally, we have a policy team that works with regulators for free and fair regulation for plant-based, cultivated, as well as fermentation-derived protein. And we also work with government agencies globally to increase investments in sustainable protein R&D. All of the affiliates and agencies that I talk, all of the affiliate offices that I spoke to you about work towards the common mission that drives our work, which is how can we feed 10 billion people by 2050 through systems that do not negatively impact climate, biodiversity, and scarce natural resources.
The current food industry is something which is causing more sickness than health. And the reason I say this is because in Bombay, the Bombay Municipal Corporation, which is the richest municipal corporation in the world, but it's still stuck with the 140-year-old drainage system. Now, all its sewage, treated and untreated, gets dumped into the Arabian Sea. What happens is that the fish eats a potty, we eat them. Then we have gutter water farming, which is alongside central, western, and the harbor lines, which grows radish, lady's finger, spinach, cauliflower, and many other green veggies. And these veggies have found high toxic in them. You said by 2050, we'll need to feed a huge Indian population. Globally also, the population is growing. We are now 7.9 billion at this point of time. Now, 8% of the world populations are vegetarian or vegan. 90% of the population are non-veg meat eaters. Now, poultry farming in India are known to produce chickens with the world's strongest dose of antibiotics to promote growth. Now, the study of the Bureau of Investigative Journalism suggests that colistin, an antibiotic of last resort, are administered regularly in Indian poultry farms. And if you visit slaughterhouse, I'm sure people will either cut down or stop eating meat completely. And post-pandemic, everyone has kind of knows the dangers of zoonotic disease. The entire food system needs an overhaul. And there's so much wrong with the food system. So, Akshay, would you like to take this question? What's wrong with the current food producing system and how can we correct it?
Hey, thanks, Eddie, and thanks for inviting me to participate in this podcast. If you ask me, my answer is everything is wrong. Basically, the global food system is how food is produced, processed and distributed across the world. The crux of the problem is how food is produced, and within food, especially animal-derived food products such as meat, eggs and dairy, how they are produced basically. So when people and governments used to talk about food security, let's say a decade ago, it meant that as a nation such as our country, we need to have sufficient quantities of food which is affordable, healthy and nutritious to all our citizens, and this stands true to all nations globally. However, I think over the last decade, the definition has more or less changed. There is an additional term of sustainability to this definition, which is so critical. And an article recently published in Hindu in August last year, I think, says that in 2016, nearly 27.8% of the Indian population suffered from moderate to severe food insecurity. And as of today, this number stands at 31.6%. That is approximately 50 crore people of India are facing this food insecurity. And the report claims that India accounts for more than 1/5 of the global burden of food insecurity. The global population is expected to hit 10 billion by 2050, and India will be at the forefront, accounting for nearly 17% or 1.6 billion of the 10 billion of the population in 2050. So with such staggering numbers and the accelerating food insecurity, the current modalities of how food is produced, especially animal protein, which is going to get even more worse if we do not address some of the very pressing issues on how this protein is actually produced. So the world now produces more than 3 times the quantity of meat it did 50 years ago. Meat consumption increases as the world is getting richer. And in 2018, the production was around 340 million tons. And 80 billion animals are slaughtered each year for meat. So if you come to milk, the world now produces approximately 800 million tons of milk each year. That is more than double the amount 50 years ago. So adding a very Indian lens to this, the number of food insecure people in India, like I said, have grown humongously over the last, say, 4 or 5 years. So achieving domestic and global food and nutrition security reliably is truly a very big challenge and probably one of the most pressing issues of our time, like I said before. The search for sustainable food and nutrition security solutions will get even more complicated. And basically, with the backdrop of the limited availability of water, finite amount of land for agriculture, and the way we actually produce meat is we actually grow crops, feed them to animals, and then procure this meat by sacrificing these animals, which is vastly inefficient and has several repercussions on environment, inflating prices of grains, legumes, etc., which ultimately leads to poverty. So industrial livestock farming also contributes nearly 18% of global greenhouse gas emissions, which is shockingly a much higher value compared to the transport sector itself. So just an example here, a chicken converts 1 calorie of the total of 9 calories supplied to it into meat. And 75% of the total land globally is used for livestock farming, which is still unable to cater to a larger segment of the growing population globally. The other key issue, like you mentioned, Eddie, is the antimicrobial resistance or antibiotic resistance. And as I think everyone has witnessed over the last couple of years, COVID-19, 20, and still continuing to 21, and hopefully we don't have a much more persistent pandemic anymore. There has been substantial evidence that such animal-derived microbial infections could lead to much more devastating pandemics in the future, stemming from the sheer amount of antibiotics fed to animals today. So it is estimated that 10 million annual deaths will occur because of antimicrobial resistance by 2060, which is several folds higher compared to current numbers. And bypassing the animal, basically the middleman, and processing more plants or culturing more cells or doing fermentation, which I'll come to a little bit later, into meat and cultivating meat from such modalities into food for human consumption is perhaps the best way we can, and perhaps the only way we can actually provide sustainable food solutions to this fast-growing global population.
Right, right. So you mentioned, I mean, the current food production system is completely not sustainable. And then we have innovation in the ecosystem through various means and processes where we can look at the future of food, right? So I'm excited for that, and we'll definitely get into the like what are the different possible ways where we can alternatively produce protein. Nicole, I'll get to you. So, you know, globally there is great innovation happening when it comes to the future of food. There are already companies such as Impossible Food, Beyond Meat, and so on and so forth, who are like really innovating when it comes to the future of food and finding ways to create, you know, different kinds of alternative protein. So Akshay, would you like to talk about and explain what smart protein or alternative food is? Because at this point in time, it's a little confusing. You know, when you say smart protein, could you like break it down for my listeners, please?
Absolutely, absolutely. So what is smart protein? By definition, the smart protein is basically a rapidly growing global industry offering a safe, nutritious, as well as a sustainable solution to animal source protein. So smart protein foods basically replicate the sensory and the culinary and the cultural experience of meat, eggs, and dairy, but are made from exclusively either plant-based ingredients or directly from culturing animal cells, which we call as cultivated meat, or through microorganisms, which we have the term called as fermentation, which means they also vastly use less amount of land and water with tremendously lower greenhouse gas emissions and probably are very, very have very vastly less risk of, let's say, public health in terms of infectious diseases. Our MD, Mr. Varun Deshpande, mentions this very frequently, and I'm just borrowing his lines or his words, that just smartphones leapfrogged over telephone lines and catapulted India to the digital age, we have a chance to leapfrog over industrial animal agriculture to produce proteins that taste probably the same or much, much better and cost the same or less as compared to animal-derived proteins.
Nicole, I'll go back to you. How are Indian startups doing in the smart protein space?
Yeah, thanks, Eddie. So globally, 2020 was actually a record year for investments in alternative protein companies globally. We saw a $3.1 billion invested in companies across the world. And interestingly, APAC is actually the fastest growing region for alternative proteins globally. And plant protein seems to be an emerging trend across India. And we're seeing this as well in terms of this number of startups that we've been working with. So across all categories of plant-based, fermentation, and cultivated, currently there are about 50 different startups that are at different levels of product development. We're mostly seeing companies within the plant-based space, we're hoping for more sort of momentum to push forward the cultivated and fermentation space as well that we're extremely bullish about. But what we're really excited about is a couple of startups that are really catapulting the consumer awareness of and category awareness of these types of products within India. So Imagine Meats, which was founded by Bollywood couple Janelia and Ritesh Deshmukh. We're super excited about that because we think having companies like that join this plant-based meat movement in India is likely to position these products to the mass market because of the founder's mass appeal, of course. And of course, we hope to see continued momentum, and we're hoping to see more companies come forward as several of the initiatives that we're planning across our departments come into fruition. We're hoping to see a much larger number of companies being launched. We're hoping to see new product launches over the coming months, and essentially companies scaling across India.
when you say that, you know, we are redesigning food, it's difficult to fathom, because, you know, for age old, I mean, we've been having food which has been naturally produced. Now we are at the cusp of redesigning food. Now that's exciting. Though there is, you know, one side where we are tinkering with the source code of nature, you know, we're redesigning food that at times might not go well with people. But I guess the narrative needs to go out to the people saying that this has a lot of advantages and benefit. And I guess, and that can only happen once there's a community and awareness. And I wish you the very best, because I think you guys are doing really a good thing by raising awareness and building a community towards that. So, Akshay, coming back to you, you know, would you like to break this down, you know, for my audience? Because you said that there's plant-based, there's cultivated meat, and there's fermentation-derived meat. What do you mean by that? What is the process?
So, smart protein basically consists of three verticals, say from a production as well as an infrastructural perspective. Plant-based meat, eggs, and dairy, the first vertical. The second one being cultivated meat, eggs, and dairy. And the third one is fermentation-derived proteins. So, plant-based meat closely resembles, let's say, a conventionally derived meat product, animal meat product. And in its organoleptic properties, meaning its look, taste, and mouthfeel, and this made only by using a combination of plant or crop ingredients such as pea or soy protein. For example, Impossible Foods, which is a US-based alternative protein company or a smart protein company, which is now kind of celebrity of sorts in the sector, makes its burger using soy and potatoes. For fat content, they use a blend of different oils such as coconut as well as sunflower oils. And for binders, which will help bind these, let's say, plant proteins together, they use components from methyl cellulose and food starch, which is completely safe, which also holds this meat together. So this is then made into patties and meatballs and then put into burgers. And like this, there are several such companies. For example, there's one more company called Beyond Meat, which has a combination of pea and moon proteins and certain edible oils. And they claim that their product is completely free of GMOs, nitrites, hormones, soy, and also gluten. So numerous such companies have also emerged in India, and I think Nicole did touch upon that as well, which will help or cater to the increasing demand for plant-based proteins, both locally as well as in the international markets. So the second vertical is what we call as cultivated meat. It is known by several names such as cultured meat, cell-based, or even synthetic meat, which we have come across in India as well, so it is definitely not palatable. We at GFI India prefer the term cultivated meat because it sits well in terms of consumer perspective as well as acceptance. So cultivated meat is basically produced using existing tissue engineering techniques, which have been widely employed in biotechnology before for several decades. So basically, we cut out the middleman, take the cells and put them in a culture, basically in a lab, and create a cell line, which is basically a set of cells which can grow either indefinitely or very, let's say, financially for a very, very long term. And so that you can get cells in very, let's say, large scales or astronomical scales, which is very essential for creating something like a meat product. So it basically involves various steps like, you know, starting with a cell starter culture, using a combination of cells such as muscle cells, which is very important for meat. Then also employing fat cells and other support cells and growing them in combination or independently, and then combining these and then creating something called as minced meat product or something of that sort. So taking this step ahead, the next thing is how we can make this more structured. So companies and researchers across the world are employing a technology called as scaffolding, where let's say a component serves as a base where the cells can be seeded and grown, so that ultimately, when the cells mature and, you know, you get the real meat, it looks like the whole cut meat which you get from animals such as steak, right? So that's one more area. And there are several other next step things which are happening. For example, people are also looking at 3D printed meat. I don't know how much of, let's say, traction that field is going to take, or is it going to take off in the near future. But yeah, I mean, there are several angles which people are exploring in terms of cultivating meat. So, yeah, basically, this starts at the bench scale, that's basically in a lab, And then it is taken forward into, let's say, mini pilot scale facilities, small bioreactors where they can grow, let's say, cells in billions. And then the last phase is basically industrialization, where people employ large bioreactors, cultivators with probably volumes running into thousands or even millions, and to produce basically cells in trillions of numbers to cater to the bigger market across. So that's more or less about cultivated meat. So now moving to the third vertical, that is fermentation. So fermentation involves basically microbiology. In other words, microbial species are employed to actually produce proteins. So this could be in crude formations, such as, you know, whole cell fermentation, which we call as biomass fermentation, where large quantities of protein are produced, although they are very crude. The quality of the protein is crude. The second one is basically precision fermentation, where, you know, companies employ microorganisms to produce very high value ingredients, although in lesser quantities. But compared to other modes of production, I think fermentation serves as a very promising platform in terms of producing these proteins cost effectively, and also in terms of keeping, let's say, the quality of the protein intact.
Right. So actually, I'm going to maybe like probe that a little bit further. You know, you said, because, I mean, you know, evolution has taken over millions of years, you know, to create a natural source of a protein, a natural source of food, you know, but then at this point in time, we kind of understanding ways to tinker it around and create the next step or the next evolution of food. Now, how we at a very nascent stage of this, how far or close are we to create food or meat which has the same texture, the same feel? Will we ever be able to come closer to creating bones? Because, I mean, you know, when you talk about meat, it comes with a lot of flavors. You know, that there is the meat itself, there's the fat, the flesh, the tissues, there's the bones. So there is so much that goes into making that. Are we doing a deep dive into understanding or going closer to emulating the actual meat? Is that a possibility? If yes, what would be the timelines to create meat that when we put in a mouth with eyes closed, eye open, we realize that, oh, this is it. That's the real meat.
I think this is good. This is an evolving space, and we, like Nicole mentioned, there are billions being pumped into the sector, because people see that that is a promise, that this is going to be delivered at some point in time, either in the next 3-4 years, or probably in the next decade, or probably in the next 20 years, when companies achieve this cost versus, let's say, taste parity across conventionally, as compared to conventionally produced animal meat. So personally, I feel that fermentation will rapidly pick up from compared to cultivated meat in the next 1 or 2 years, and probably cultivated meat would take a little more time because it is very, very technologically driven, and it might take a little more time to actually capture that market and become a market leader. But I feel that in the next 20, 30 years, or probably up to 2050, cultivated meat is going to be the market leader in all these three verticals, and will significantly replace conventionally derived animal meat.
Right. Yeah, I guess there's some great things which are happening, and which you thought was not possible is being made possible. You know, so I'm excited for the space. So Nicole, coming back to you now, food is something which is almost, I mean, at least for Indians, it's very special. You know, so what do you think needs to be done to create a narrative when we have startups building these alternative protein or smart protein, and which is ready to go to market? What do you think would be the narrative that should be played out? You know, because there always will be the conversation of natural versus unnatural. Over the years, everything, almost all the foods that we eat is somewhere down the line is genetically modified, you know, be it papayas, watermelons, and bananas, and so on and so forth. And the list is quite endless. it has helped in a production scale and things like that. But we were not tinkering it in a way with right now how we tinkering with biotech, you know, where we are actually, you know, tinkering around with, you know, the going to the a specific DNA and things like that. So there is a great opportunity for, you know, creating the future of the food. But what do you think should be the narrative to the people, at least here in India? Because, you know, the first thing that people take in is that natural versus unnatural conversation. Oh, that this was food. This is what we have grown up in. How can you tinker around with the food? So would that be a challenge here in India, according to you?
Thanks for that. I think not necessarily just in India, but globally, food is quite... food brings people together. Food is culturally very significant all across the world. When we're talking about the foods that we're talking about, so plant-based, fermentation, cultivated, we don't necessarily mean genetically modified. We're talking about it more from an angle of a food processing lens. And GFI India has run a bunch of consumer research studies, actually. So in 2018, while only 39% of respondents to our consumer survey were had any sort of awareness about what plant-based meats were, in 2020, we saw a 54% respondent rate. Of people having an awareness actually about what this category is. And within those respondents, we saw that 77% of them were likely to try plant-based meats, and about 73% of them were likely to actually purchase them regularly. So though this category is still in its early stages in India, we're seeing a really high positive disposition for these types of products, especially by early adopters. Their proxies for trying some of these products are not only just driven by health, but are also driven by aspects like animal cruelty and impact on the planet. The Beyond Burger, the Impossible Burger, is a hero product in the US. The burger might not be a hero product in India. And so we're seeing a bunch of startups come up with the right Indianized version of those plant-based meat formats in India. We're seeing plant-based mutton samosas. We're seeing plant-based chicken shami kebabs. We're seeing things that really appeal to the Indian market. And apart from that early adopter cohort that we spoke about as well, these products are very much meant for the flexitarian or the non-vegetarian population that are already eating meat. These products aren't meant to taste like your first-generation soya nuggets, which were meant to be a high-protein alternative for the vegetarian population. These products taste the same, they look the same, they smell the same, they cook the same as your conventional meat products. And contrary to, you know, popular belief, India is not a vegetarian country per se. So 71% of India's 1.3 billion people already self-identify as non-vegetarian. And this is as per the last census survey that was run in 2014. And with 60% of this population actually eating meat at least occasionally. And most of these respondents cited income rather than religious structures as the major impediment for not eating meat more frequently. So we're hoping, and you know, Akshay mentioned as well, this leapfrogging almost of industrial animal agriculture. So why not skip that phase altogether and go directly to some of these meat alternatives that give people the indulgence that they seek from meat, but without all the negative externalities associated with, you know, industrial animal agriculture.
Just adding a little more perspective to what Nicole just said, I think this market is just going to grow, right? It's not going to go down. In other words, I think if the younger tech-savvy population are consuming more of, let's say, smart proteins, then I think that is a population which is going to be probably the majority of the population by 2050. So. Yeah, that's how it's going to grow.
Right. And I guess the younger population are more aware and they are more responsible. So if there's a narrative created with possibly maybe celebrities endorsing and creating the narrative that there is an impact on environment because of the current food production system, and push forward that what we have been doing with animal cruelty, you know, and create some empathy. I guess there will be a natural movement towards this alternative protein. Now, there is great innovation happening globally. You know, you spoke about 3D printing. There's a startup in Israel which is 3D printing meat, and they are also personalizing the food according to you. So we are going into some, you know, a great space, a great future for us when it comes to everything, not just food. As a biotech expert, is there an approach you favor which you think will have mass appeal and will be scalable?
I mean, I don't have a concrete answer for this, to be very honest, as to what approach would actually be the best in terms of, you know, pursuing cross plant-based, cultivated or fermentation. I think, like I mentioned before, probably we should probably leave it to the market to analyze and understand as to which of these products would the larger mass actually consume and prefer moving forward. And as people, consume less of conventional meat, more of, let's say, plant-based diets or something which is derived out of smart proteins, I think that will give us a much, much better picture or perspective in terms of which of these could be the ultimate, let's say, winner.
Right. Yeah. So Nicole, I was on the website, GFI website, and I saw that Indra Nui is one of the who's endorsing your company, and not just GFI, but also the future of food. What has been the support system so far? Because see, this is something which is in a very nascent stage. It's just kind of, you know, we're just kind of figuring out the nitty-gritties of what this future of food, alternative, smart protein is going to look like. How is the ecosystem being here in India? The investor, the government system, would you like to talk about that?
To your point, she is a huge champion for the alternative protein sector globally. In India specifically, we feel like India has a huge role to play for the global alternative protein sector. And there are a couple of points that I want to quickly talk about. So India, as we all know, has tremendous crop biodiversity, with crops such as pulses and millets, which has a huge promise to diversify the raw materials actually used in the entire global alternative protein raw material supply chain. So there's a number of startups that we're working here that are looking to leverage some of these underexploited and diversified and as well as high protein crop varieties, working on them and optimizing them for superior functionalities as well as inherent nutrition completeness, so that then when they are used in some of these plant-based meat or dairy or egg products, they lend themselves to cleaner label products because they are optimized specifically for use within those products. Apart from that, India, of course, has its existing capabilities both in biopharmaceutical manufacturing as well as in fermentation. And both of these lend themselves quite well to the cultivated meat as well as the fermentation-derived sector that Akshay spoke about as well. And so we're seeing startups in India developing products that can act as raw materials as well as ingredients providers for some of these startups globally. And fermentation, as Akshay spoke about, is particularly compelling for low and middle income contexts just because of the costs and scale and adaptability to diverse feedstocks. So here as well, we're seeing a lot of investor interest because they feel like fermentation can play a really important role in de-risking the entire alternative protein industry at scale by sort of improving the resiliency as well as the environmental sustainability of producing protein in this manner. The opportunity that we're looking for in India is a 10-year horizon. This is very much a sunrise sector. By 2030, countries like India and China are actually going to be the highest contributors to the increase in protein demand globally. And so a lot of investors are betting on that extended time horizon, that 2030 time horizon. So a lot of the work that we're doing here is actually building out that ecosystem to anticipate that demand that's going to be coming in over the next couple of years. And of course, very much seeing India as a manufacturer for the rest of the world.
Lovely. Yeah, more power to you, because we need more players to kind of lay down the foundation of the building blocks of, you know, what the future of food is going to look like. So Akshay, would you like to talk about the latest innovations that you're seeing in the space which has caught your attention? And when do you think we're going to be seeing here, at least here in India, smart protein on a dinner table?
When we can actually see meat on our dinner tables, it depends on whose dinner table you're talking about. Because plant-based meat is already available in probably some of the supermarkets, not probably in India, but elsewhere as well. Correct me if I'm wrong, Nicole. And several food aggregators are foraying into this sector, supporting the launch of new products in the market. So Domino's Pizza, for example, which I think every other city dweller in India knows and relates to, has already launched their first plant-based pizza. So something of this sort, I think we are moving towards a place where this kind of products are becoming more and more affordable. Another instance is Just Eat, a cultivated meat company. It recently got regulatory approvals in Singapore and launched their chicken cultivated chicken nuggets, firstly in one of the very high-end restaurants in Singapore, and later moved on to a food aggregator, which is called as Food Panda, which basically caters to online delivery, things of that sort. So Fiok Meats is another company which is based out of Singapore, and they're claiming that they'll get their first product out by early next year. Again, this is going to be in high-end restaurants. The cost of cultivated meat is also coming down significantly. In 2013, when the first cultivated meat burger was, that was a tasting session in 2013, basically, by the creator of this, that's Mark Post. And at that point in time, the cost of one burger was $300,000. So that's humongous, right? No, nobody can actually afford that. But now you see, probably 8 years down the line, the cost, the companies, basically this guy is, he's a co-founder of a company called as Mosa Meat. So Mosa Meat is now claiming that they have reduced the cost of cultured media by 80x, that is 80 times. They've got down the cost of fat component of their cultivated meat by 66 times or 65 times. And they're also claiming that by next year, they'll be able to launch their cultivated burger in probably supermarket mega chains at the cost of $10 per burger. So that's a huge cost reduction you're seeing. And ultimately, what I would like to say is that currently it is probably available only for, let's say, the affluent segment of the populations globally. But moving forward, probably it's going to come to the table of a middle-class family. And several years down the line, probably you can see that every other single man who probably in the lowest income brackets could afford an alternative meat or a smart protein product.
Nicole, I mean, it's not just your meat, right? It's not just your meat product. There are people who are innovating with egg and cheese and so on and so forth. So could you talk a little bit more about that? Which are the alternative food products there's going to be alternates of? And what are the initiatives of GFI? Is there anything that you're building push this ecosystem forward?
Yeah, sure. So you're right. It's not just meat that we're talking about. We're talking about meat. We're talking about eggs. We're talking about dairy. And we've seen some of these products launch within the Indian market. So we see companies like Blue Tribe Foods, that came out with a plant-based chicken nugget last year. There's a company in Bangalore, a startup called Shakahari, that launched the plant-based mutton samosas that I was talking about, and actually just tried this weekend and had my family try as well. And my family very much eats meat and was also pleasantly surprised by how meat-like this product tasted. You have companies like Good Milk, offering plant-based dairy products. So not just plant-based milk, but plant-based butters, plant-based yogurt. And then again, you have companies that are innovating in the field of eggs. While no products have come out in the market yet, there are companies that are currently working on it, and we expect for them to have launches later this year. But in saying that, the Good Food Institute India works with startups and you know, formal companies across the value chain, and works with companies at different levels of their product development across plant-based, across fermentation, across cultivated. And one thing that we found that all of these companies really need right now, especially given how nascent the ecosystem currently is in India, is a community to rally them and to support them. And so we have a GF Ideas India community that we're really proud of. It's a 650 member plus community with stakeholders across entrepreneurs, investors, scientists, food professionals, you know, that are very much interested in this sector. And since we are a nonprofit agency, of course, this is a completely free community that you can join. And any of your listeners, if they are interested, are free to join. And we do a lot of research that I like the consumer research that I spoke about earlier in this podcast. We do a lot of consumer research. The science and technology team that Akshay is in have done a bunch of strategic analyses in different areas across these different technology areas that are most relevant to India and what we see as white space opportunities for entrepreneurs and investors to really come in and take advantage of. And so research like that, we have a number of databases and directories that we're constantly building up, whether that's for entrepreneurs that are seeking investments or investors that are looking to invest in, you know, some of the largest or some of the most promising alternative protein startups in India. We have a ecosystem database that we're building out for innovators and entrepreneurs that are looking to scale up their production and are looking for a co-manufacturer, they're looking for a co-packer. We provide all this information and all this supporting infrastructure for the community to really take advantage of. And of course, all we ask is that people bring in their interest within the sector and are really looking to work with each other to really push forward this sector in India and globally. Apart from that, this year we'll be launching the second iteration of our innovation challenge. We ran an innovation challenge last year that was entirely focused on the plant-based sector. This year we're sort of extending that to include both fermentation as well as cultivated as well. It'll be open to students as well as entrepreneurs and young professionals that are really looking to enter this sector. And we'll be providing them with a sort of 5-month acceleration roadmap almost, where providing them with all the resources that they'd require to understand what this industry is really all about, as well as specific opportunities that we feel they could tap into and really excel in. So that's something that we'll be launching in August of this year. So for anyone listening, if this is of interest, definitely look out for that. And then apart from that, we have a flagship summit that we host every year. We started hosting it in 2018. We'll be hosting our fourth iteration of that in November of this year. So again, anyone interested in the sector and really looking to understand how India fits into this global landscape of alternative proteins should definitely register for that and attend that when we do launch it in November. It'll be a mostly virtual event, so accessible to anyone with an internet connection, really. So definitely look out for that one as well.
We're getting into a super, super exciting world. And now both of you have been vested in this space for quite a long time. Would you like to paint a picture of what the future of protein, future of food is going to look like in this decade for India?
Honestly, in a nutshell, GFI India's theory of change is to make something people want. We don't want to ask meat consumers to stop consuming meat. We don't want to tell people what they should and shouldn't be consuming. This isn't really a moral debate or a moral argument, but simply we want to give consumers the meat that they love but in a way that is better for the world and better for business. So what we're really trying to do is give you the meat that you love, that tastes the same and costs the same, and so gives you a viable alternative for something that you're already familiar with and something that you really do want to consume. And that's exactly what we're working to build in India and locally.
Yeah, I can quickly jump in and say that one of the other aspects which GFI India, GFI Global Impact focuses on is science and technology, research and development. So that is one of our biggest focuses in terms of promoting open access smart protein research projects. And we have a dedicated science and technology team for that globally. And we also have this iteration of this annual GFI grant program where researchers and scientists across the world can apply for these grants and create research, which is open access to everyone, each and everyone who wants to read about what they've done with that project. So we've also built a science and technology community in India, which we recently launched. We recently had the first sciencey kind of a webinar, which was just focused for scientists and researchers in terms of publications in very high impact journals such as Nature and Science. By that, you can understand that how seriously this field is moving forward when we have publications in very highly reputed journals. But yeah, overall, I feel that, you know, in India, the sector is picking up in terms of research and development. We have had a grant which was awarded to the Center of Cellular and Molecular Biology in which is located in Hyderabad, an amount of 4.6 crore rupees to do research on cultivated mutton meat. And one of the other stakeholders, Dr. Vinod Verma from Sanjay Gandhi Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Lucknow, was awarded a 50 lakh grant to do open access research, again, in developing stem cells or cell lines in cultivated mutton as well as in chicken. We have had a couple of startups in India as well for focusing on cultivated meat. We have Clear Meat, which is focusing on creating cultivated chicken as well as mutton, and we have a scaffolding company like what I explained before in terms of scaffolding. The company's name is MyoWorks, which is developing scaffolds for cultivated meat products. They basically function as enablers within this ecosystem to help companies which are focused on end product to launch their products in the market. So I think I just wanted to get this perspective out and just to cover up, I'm sorry, just to round up what Nicole just mentioned about how and where we see our ecosystem moving forward in 10 years. What we expect and what we believe we want to do is the next 10 years, we want to have more such grant programs, more open access research, so that people, a common man, can go and read such white papers and publications, start feeling safe, start trusting such products, and probably over a period of time, we'll see more acceptance.
For the first time in the history of human civilization, we've got the opportunity to correct the wrongs. The environment, which is screaming for attention, you know, I mean, there's climate crisis. Just recently, I think, in Canada, there was a heat wave, hundreds have died. 101 Nobel laureates assigned that how we are staring at a climate crisis, and our production of food is one of the cause because of the climate problem. And plus, it's not more about being morally or ethically right about eating meat, but it's just that if we understand that and respect each and every species, you know, and we care for others, I think we'll create a better planet, because there needs to be empathy towards our animals. So far, the way we have treated animals is not right. And now we have this option of creating or redesigning the future of food. So I'm really excited for that. And I hope that this vision plays out without any obstruction. So wish you the very best, and thank you for being part of the podcast. And to my listeners, if you like what you see and hear, please press the subscribe button. And until next time, see you guys. Bye-bye. Thank you.